Good evening and welcome to our evening prayer. In the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We have come together as the family of God in our Father's presence to offer him praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive his holy word, to bring before him the needs of the world, to ask his forgiveness of our sins, and to seek his grace, that through his Son, Jesus Christ, we may give ourselves to his service. He who reigns shall come in glory. Let us worship and praise him. Lord, open our lips, that we may glorify and praise your name. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Praise the Lord. Alleluia. Let us call to mind and confess our sin. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, in penitence we confess that we have sinned against you through our own fault, in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have left undone. For the sake of your Son, Christ our Lord, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Almighty God, have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and keep us in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our appointed psalm for this evening is Psalm 47 and 48. Oh, clap your hands, all you peoples, and cry aloud to God with shouts of joy. For the Lord Most High is to be feared. He is a great king over all the earth. He cast down peoples under us and the nations beneath our feet. He chose us a land for our possession. That was the bride of Jacob whom he loved. God has gone up with the sound of rejoicing and the Lord to the blast of the horn. Oh, sing praises to God. Oh, sing praises to our King. For God is the King of all the earth. Oh, praise him in a well-wrought psalm. God has become the King of the nations. He has taken his seat upon his holy throne. The princes of the peoples are gathered together with the people of the God of Abraham. For the mighty ones of the earth have become the servants of God, and he is greatly exalted. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised in the city of our God, high and beautiful in his holy hills. It is the joy of all the earth. On Mount Zion, where Godhead truly dwells, stands the city of the great King. God is well known in her places as a sure defense. For the King of the earth assembled, they gathered together and came on. They saw, they were struck dumb. They were astonished and fled in terror. Trembling took hold on them, and anguish as on woman on her travail. Like the breath of the east wind that shatters the ships of Tarshish. As we have heard, so have we seen, in the city of the Lord of hosts, in the city of our God, which God has established forever. We have called to mind your loving kindness, O God, in the midst of your temple. As your name is great, O God, so also is your praise, even to the end of the earth. Your right hand is full of glory. Your right hand is full of victory. Let Zion's hill rejoice. Let the daughters of Judah be glad because of your judgments. Walk about Zion, go round about her, and count all her towers. Consider her well, her ramparts, pass through her palaces. And you may tell those who come after that, such is God. Our God is ever and ever, and will guide us eternally. Glory to God, source of all being, eternal Word and Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, now and will be forever. Amen. Our first lesson is written in the book of Zechariah, chapter 3, verses 1 to 10. In another vision, the Lord showed me the high priest Joshua standing before the angel of the Lord. And there beside Joshua stood Satan, ready to bring an accusation against him. The angel of the Lord said to Satan, "May the Lord condemn you, Satan. May the Lord who loves Jerusalem condemn you. This man is like a stick snatched from the fire." Joshua was standing there, wearing filthy clothes. The angel said to his heavenly attendants, "Take away the filthy clothes this man is wearing." Then he said to Joshua, "I have taken away your sin and will give you new clothes to wear." He commanded the attendants to put a clean turban on Joshua's head. They did so. And then they put new clothes on him, while the angel of the Lord stood there. Then the angel told Joshua that the Lord Almighty had said, "If you obey my laws and perform the duties I have assigned to you, then you will continue to be in charge of my temple and its cause. And I will hear your prayers, just as I hear the prayers of the angels who are in my presence. Listen then, Joshua, you who are the high priest, and listen, you fellow priests of his, you that are the sign of a good future. I will reveal my servant, who is called the branch. I'm placing in front of Joshua a single stone with seven facets. I will engrave an inscription on it. And in a single day, I'll take away the sin of this land. When that day comes, each of you will invite his neighbor to come and enjoy peace and security, surrounded by your vineyards and fig trees." Here ends our first lesson.
Magnificat. Anima mea Dominum.
Et exultavit spiritus meus. In Deus salutari meo.
Quia respexit humilitatem ancile suae. Senim ex hoc beata medicent omnes generationes.
Quia fecit mi magna qui potens est, et sanctum nomen eius.
Et misericordia eius a progenie in progenie. Dimentibus eum.
Fecit potentiam in brachio suum. Dispersit superbos mente cordi sui.
De possuit potentes te sede. Exaltavit humile.
Iesu oriente simple diponis, et ibit est dimisit in anes.
Suscepit Israel puerum suum. Recordatus misericordiae suae.
Sic ut locutus est ad patres nostros, Abraham et semini eius in saecula.
Gloria Patri et Filio et Spiritui Sancto.
Sic ut erat in principio et nunc et semper, et in saecula saeculorum. Amen.
The second lesson is written in Mark chapter 1, verses 1-8. This is the good news about Jesus Christ, the Son of God. It began as the prophet Isaiah had written. God said, "I will send my messenger ahead of you to clear the way for you." Someone is shouting in the desert, "Get the road ready for the Lord. Make a straight path for him to travel." So John appeared in the desert, baptizing and preaching. "Turn away from your sin and be baptized," he told the people, "and God will forgive your sins." Many people from the province of Judea and the city of Jerusalem went out to hear John. They confessed their sins, and he baptized them in the river Jordan. John wore clothes made of camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and his food was locusts and wild honey. He announced to the people, "The man who will come after me is much greater than I am. I'm not good enough even to bend down and untie his sandals. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." Here ends the second lesson. Jesus is coming. Prepare your hearts. Sufficient preparation is important. You want to be ready to face the day or any challenges you might encounter. And sometimes those plans require modification. We are reminded again today that Advent is a season about preparation. Yes, perhaps the Christmas decorations are going up inside or outside our houses. Perhaps some presents are being bought or even wrapped. Maybe the Christmas music is playing at home or in the shopping malls where we go. These are preparations for Christmas, but these are not Advent preparations. John the Baptist leads us to see this evening that most important preparation to celebrate Jesus' coming is that we prepare our hearts. Mark wastes no time in his gospel telling us for whom we are to prepare our hearts. This is God himself, the Father's Son, coming to dwell among his people, to serve his people, and eventually to take his people home for eternal life. God had promised through the prophet Isaiah that a messenger would come to prepare the way for the Messiah. He came to make roads ready and paths straight. But John the Baptist didn't embark on a public works project to get ready for Jesus. He wasn't literally building roads and filling the potholes and repairing the roads damaged by the heavy rains. No. We heard that he went out to the Jordan, baptizing in the wilderness and preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. John's baptism was different than our baptism that Jesus would later give to his disciples. John's was a washing connected to a person's repentance. Repentance is an important but perhaps often misunderstood component of the believer's life. And Philip Melanchthon describes repentance as consisting of two parts. One part is contrition, that is, terror striking the conscience through the knowledge of sin. And the other part is faith, which is born of the gospel or the absolution and believes that for Christ's sake, sins are forgiven. It comforts the conscience and delivers it from terror. Then good works are bound to follow, which are the fruits of repentance. What was John doing as he preached in the desert? He was trying to get people to see the severity of their sin, the danger it posed for their eternal well-being, to instill in them sorrow over that sin, but also joy in God's forgiveness. The source of that forgiveness was coming, and soon. And to get his path ready, John proclaimed this message to prepare the hearts of those Jesus will come to save. Truly, this is Advent preparation in the truest sense. Truly, this is the Advent preparation in the truest sense. It shouldn't take an odd-looking fellow living in the desert to make you or me realize our need for repentance. Sin infects every part of our being, every thought, word, and action. Our lives continue to be rebelling against God. And this is why we need this time of preparation so much. Because what good is Christmas if I don't see my need, eternally need, for the Savior whose birth we will celebrate? And what good will his second advent be for me if I stand on my own, confident on my own good works for my salvation? Though Advent, we strive to prepare our hearts, to identify those places where sin has taken a hold of us, and to purge it from our lives. As we find sin, we repent and turn away from it. The way we get ready to celebrate Christmas is the same way John got the people ready for Jesus' first arrival. And in fact, it is the same way we get ready for Jesus' second arrival. Without repentance, Christmas is just Santa and presents, or family and church traditions devoid of any eternal meaning. But with repentance, with sorrow over our sin, and trust that God has in fact forgiven us, we see in Jesus' first arrival the assurance that God loves us, the assurance that God keeps his promises, the assurance that there is forgiveness. This is the same hope that John's baptism brought. After all, it was a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. That certainty of forgiveness for them depended on God's promises to send their Savior. The certainty of our forgiveness depends on that same promise, but now fulfilled, that our Savior has come. Our Savior lived. Our Savior died and rose again for us. Amen. Profess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. Lord, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, the glory are yours, forever and ever. Amen. Show us your mercy, O Lord, and grant us your salvation. O Lord, be gracious to our land, and mercifully hear us when we call upon you. Let your priests be clothed with righteousness, and let your servants shout for joy. O Lord, make your ways known upon the earth. Let all nations acknowledge your saving power. Give your people the blessing of peace, and let your glory be over all the world. Make our hearts clean, O God, and renew a right spirit within us. Now collect for the week. God of hope and joy, you sent John the Baptist to announce the coming of your Son. Inspire all who serve in your church to prepare for his coming again by turning us from disobedience to your loving service. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Eternal God, from whom all desires, all good counsels, and all just work proceeds, give your servants that peace which the world cannot give, that our hearts may be set to obey your commandments, and that free from the fear of our enemies, we may pass our time in rest and quietness. Through the merits of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Lighten our darkness, Lord, and by your great mercy defend us in all perils and dangers of the night. For the love of your only Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forever. Amen. Good night.